Will you please pray with me? Dear Father, we thank you so much for giving your Son, Jesus. Jesus, who is Emmanuel, God with us. Yes, God, you are here. You are here with us. And you are Emmanuel, and you are beautiful. Lord, I pray that we pray together as your people, that in this service you would open our eyes to see the angels all around us. Open our ears to hear your voice. Open our hearts to receive you and be the Lord of our life, that we would seek you. Because when you are so beautiful and when your eyes are on us as your children, then your grace abounds. Hear our prayers, hear our songs, bless the message, and may we truly leave as a changed people, because you are holy, and you alone are holy. Please rise to sing, "You Are Holy."
The holy God whom we worship is indeed here in this place. Receive his welcome, his greeting. Grace to you and peace from him who was and who is to come, and from the sevenfold Spirit before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of all the kings and all the peoples of the earth. And together God's people say, amen. Amen. Welcome to everyone who is here this morning. Welcome to everyone who is joining online. We pray that together we join our hearts and voices in giving glory to our holy and loving God. God has greeted us. Let's spend a few moments welcoming and greeting the people around us.
Our Lenten journey to the cross, with all the rich promises made possible by Jesus' death and resurrection, we marvel in our sovereign God, displayed in Jesus Christ, who in the church's ancient story is the promised Son of David, who was born as Son of Mary, who lives forever as Son of God.
We give thanks for our Redeemer, who is Emmanuel, God with us.
He who did not spare his own Son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? If God is for us, who can be against us?
We thank you, Lord, that you are not only with us, but for us.
In Jesus' closing words to his disciples at the Last Supper, he also declared, "Remain in me, and I will remain in you."
We thank you, Lord, for being with us, for us, and in us.
Forsake you. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged.
The eternal God is our refuge, and his everlasting arms are under us.
Let the beloved of the Lord rest secure in him, for he shields him all day long, and the one of the Lord loves rest between his shoulders.
Thank you.
I lift my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from?
My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth.
May we take to heart all the words God spoke to Moses, which he declared to Israel, so that you may command your children to obey carefully all the words of this law. They are not just idle words for you. They are your life.
You shall have no other gods before me.
For from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be the glory forever.
You shall not make for yourself an idol.
In Christ we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation.
You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless who misuses his name.
Let us continually offer to God a sacrifice of praise, the fruit of lips that confess his name.
Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God.
Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom, and as you sing psalms, hymns, and songs of the Spirit, with gratitude in your hearts to God.
Honor your father and your mother, so that you may live long in the land the Lord your God is giving you.
Children, obey your parents in everything, for this pleases the Lord.
You shall not murder.
Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you.
You shall not commit adultery.
You are not your own. You were bought at a price. Therefore, honor God with your body.
You shall not steal.
Those who have been stealing must steal no longer, but must work, doing something useful with their hands, so that they may have something to share with those in need.
You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor.
Instead of speaking the truth in love, we will let all things grow up into him who is the head, that is Christ.
You shall not covet your neighbor's house or anything that belongs to your neighbor.
I have learned to be content, whatever the circumstances.
Thank you.
I'd like to invite Nichelle and Lauren to come forward. They are going to tell us about the Vacation Bible School ministry that is happening this summer. And it's on.
Good morning. Vacation Bible School this year is going to be at Faith Reformed Church, and the theme is Faith on the Farm. Those who have completed preschool through fifth grade are invited to participate. It will be Sunday, June 4th through Wednesday, June 7th. The time is 6:15 to 8:45, and your children should be receiving a yellow form tomorrow at school. And this form will be due Wednesday, April 5th, and those forms can be dropped off at the school. At the church, there, right behind the Welcome Center, is a sign-up table, and so they can be dropped off there, or they can be dropped off at the library.
And of course, it takes many, many hands to make VBS run smoothly, and so we're specifically looking for crew leaders, prayer partners, and even if you're not there the entire week, I promise we can find you a spot. So if you feel that tug on your heart to come and help with VBS, Lauren and I will be in the back by the sign-up table to answer any questions, and we also have our volunteer forms back there as well. I've been part of VBS now for, this will be my third year, and every year it ceases to amaze me, and I always get choked up about it, because to see all kids from Rock Valley come together and worship, and the adults that put in the work of everything, it's really a special thing. And so if you feel that tug on your heart, please do come talk to us, because we'd love to have you sign up and help. And thank you guys for your support and your prayers as we get ready for VBS. And please just keep the kids and the workers in your thoughts and prayers these next couple months as we get ready. Thank you.
Thank you, Lauren and Nichelle. This time, kids who are involved in children's worship, 3-, 4-, and 5-year-olds, you are welcome to head out and continue worshiping God and growing and loving and knowing Him through the Word. You can head out the back, and your teachers will be there waiting for you. The rest of us, I'd like to remind us that our offerings this week are for our mission partners. We have mission partners right here in town. We have mission partners in the Midwest. We have mission partners in other places in the United States. We have mission partners around the world, and our giving today helps support God's word going out, the message going out in word and in deed. And as usual, we have a second offering for TC Ed as well. I think those are all the announcements I have. So at this time, I would like to invite us to spend time now in prayer to our God who is with us, who listens and responds to us when we come to Him. Let's pray. Almighty Creator and compassionate Father, we believe you are the God who brings life where there is death. You are the God who calls into being things that were not. You make us new creations, crediting us with your righteousness by grace through faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you that although we were dead to sins, you breathed your new life in Christ into us and make us your children forever, filling us with your love and inviting us, as we just said in the responsive reading and in our singing, allowing that love to reflect back out through our lives for others. We pray that you will lead us increasingly into this identity all through our lives. And when we get to the end of our journey on earth, fill us with hope, knowing that you will welcome us into our eternal home with you, where we'll know perfectly who and whose we are. We pray for the DeVries family, as such things are especially at the forefront of their minds. We pray that you'll comfort them as they miss their dad, their grandpa, their great-grandpa. Remind them of your eternal promises, we pray. We lift up before you this morning loved ones who are receiving medical care. We pray for and thank you for Gary. As he has started a new immunotherapy treatment last week, we pray that you will make that effective. We pray for others who are journeying through cancer and regularly going out to receive treatments. We think of Harlan and Raj, Judy and Carrie. Strengthen them. Give them hope, we pray. We lift up those of us dealing with long-term illnesses. For those of us living with a disability. For those of us processing a traumatic experience. May we know in our minds and feel in our hearts the presence and compassion of your Son and our Lord and friend. We pray for Taryn. We pray for her spiritual as well as physical and emotional health as she follows your calling to unreached people groups. We ask your blessing on the work we have planned this week as a church. We pray for the children's worship as they're meeting right now in Sunday school after the service. Pray a blessing on the Art of Parenting group meeting this morning. Lord, we pray a blessing on GEMS and cadets, for the Bible studies and MOPS, for Love, Inc. and the ESL classes. We pray a blessing on the plans coming together for the crew big show, as well as for VBS, with Lauren and Nichelle and all the others putting the pieces together. We pray that we'll diligently do the work to which you call us without allowing it to come before you, the Lord of the work. We pray that you'll bless the work of our partners in mission, whether it's in Sioux Falls, Utah, or California, whether in Guatemala, Lithuania, or Liberia, whether close to home through Love, Inc., Justice for All, Hope Haven, and Atlas. We pray for the different agencies of the Christian Reformed Church, including this morning Calvin Seminary. We pray that you'll guide students who are close to graduating, that they may finish their exams well and step through the doors that you open for them. We pray for your world. We hear about things like the Willow Project with the news filled with both promises and protests. We pray for your wisdom. We see the destruction to wildlife and ocean habitat these huge projects have, but we also see jobs being created through a resource you've put on the planet. So we pray that you give politicians and business leaders and all of us discernment in stewarding your good creation and minimizing or in removing entirely harm to it and other people. For places experiencing war, we pray for peace. Again, Ukraine comes quickly to mind. Comfort those traumatized by devastation. Bring an end to the violence and bloodshed. For people fighting injustice and their advocates, we pray for wrongs to be made right, for fairness and righteousness to prevail, and for enemies to be reconciled. Lord, I pray now that through your Spirit, you will speak to us life-giving words. Declare your promises over our lives and the lives of those around us. We know that you are always working for our good, and we trust that you have a plan and a purpose for our lives. Help us to walk in obedience, following your lead, even when it doesn't make sense to us. So strengthen our faith, and help us to trust in you, Almighty Creator and Compassionate Father. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
Before we open God's Word together, inviting the Spirit to allow it to speak to us with His power, I'd like to invite some kids forward for a short message with them. And I want to try something a little bit different this morning. I want to see what happens if I invite forward, let's say, third, fourth, and fifth graders. I haven't tried that before. What happens if I invite some older kids up? Will you come up and join me for a few minutes? Third, fourth, fifth graders? Come and join me on the steps up here. We'll see what this experiment does. Oh, I see a few of you coming up. That's great. Normally I invite a bit younger kids, but marvelous. Thank you. This is wonderful. Huh, I've been missing out. We've got to do this more often. Look at you all. I'm going to do this every week. Wow. Thank you all for coming up. Fantastic. Thank you. This isn't long. This isn't complicated. This isn't a trick question or anything, but I wanted to show you something that I took with me and have in my pocket. It is a blue and green marble. Usually I keep this on my desk by my monitor, so I see it right in front of me. Sometimes I carry it around in my pocket like I am doing today. It's blue and green. It reminds me of planet Earth. Planet Earth has a lot of blue and has some green in it as well. And when I hold it like this, it reminds me of our Creator and Heavenly Father, because He holds the whole world in His hands. You know that, I think, right? This morning, we are going to hear a story about two sisters named Martha and Mary. I want you to especially listen about Martha. And as you listen about her in the text and in the message, I would like for you to ask yourself, is this Martha person, is she a calm person, or is she a pretty worried person? And maybe you know the answer already, but I want you to listen to the story and in the message. This Martha, is she calm or is she worried? And regardless of whether you're calm or you're worried, but maybe especially when you're worried and anxious, I'd like you to think about this marble being held in my hand, being like the world being held in God's hand, so that regardless of what we're going through, including when we're worried or nervous or sad or upset, God's holding on to things. He's holding on to the whole world, and He's holding on to you as well. Think He ever lets go? Probably not. Sound good? You glad you came up? Should I do this again sometime? Yeah? If I called you up again, would you come up again sometime? You're not so sure. Well, I guess there's only one way to find out. Maybe I'll just have to ask you again sometime in a few weeks. I want to shake up the ages and not just do the little kids. You know what I keep wanting to do sometime? I want to invite grandpas and grandmas up here and see what happens. I've never dared to do that yet, but I'm going to one day. Don't tell them that, though, okay? It'll be a secret. Let's pray before you go back to your seats. Heavenly Father, thank You that You hold the whole world in Your hands. Help us to continue to trust in You when things are going fine. Give us courage and strength and hope when we're nervous and scared. Lead and guide us Your Spirit, we pray in Jesus' name, amen. Thank you very much for coming forward. This is pretty special for me, so look forward to next time. We're looking at Luke chapter 10, the closing verses. As you heard with the kids here, it's a story about two sisters, Martha and Mary, and their encounter with Jesus. We read in verse 38 of Luke chapter 10, as Jesus and His disciples were on their way, He came to a village where a woman named Martha opened her home to Him. She had a sister called Mary who sat at the Lord's feet listening to what He said. But Martha was distracted by all the preparations that had to be made. She came to Him and asked, Lord, don't You care that my sister has left me to do the work all by myself? Tell her to help me. Martha, Martha, the Lord answered, you are worried and upset about many things, but few things are needed. Indeed, only one. Mary has chosen what is better, and it will not be taken away from her. Sisters and brothers in Christ, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So, 2 weeks ago, I spoke on the theme of, if you remember, letting go of perfection, perfectionism. Some of you are here for that. This morning, we are looking at and talking about letting go of control. Now, I don't know about you, but I have a little theory going on in the back of my mind. I think that Pastor Henry, while he is assigning these texts and themes for the services during Lent, he is looking at the schedule and which ones I'm going to preach. And I really think that Pastor Henry is trying to save the church a little bit of money by not having to pay for therapy for me and instead work through all my issues with you in front here. This is like big group therapy. I really think that that is what's going on here. Because we do see in our text a little bit of control going on in Martha. And I do think that we are invited in our text to let that go. The reason why we have this series in Lent is because people talk about sometimes giving things up for Lent. Maybe they'll give up chocolate. Maybe you give up social media. Maybe you give up trying to be first in line. Today we hear Jesus inviting us to let go of control. And as I said to somebody this past week, sometimes I think I need to hear this more than anyone else, but I suspect that in maybe ways different than me, all of us, or you and all of us in different ways, I mean to say, have things that we hold on tight to and want to be in control. So I suspect there'll be, this is for all of us to hear. Because we do get the sense that Martha wants to be in control. Lord, tell Mary to get in the kitchen where she belongs. And we hear Jesus correct her. And I hear Jesus correcting me, redirecting this desire for control. Now, before we go any further, though, I need to tell you right off the bat that I would be doing a terrible disservice if the theme of the sermon was, now don't be like Martha, but be like Mary. That cannot be the message we go home with today. Because this text and others reveal that Martha and Mary, they are real people. They are real people with complexities like you and I. They're not cardboard cartoon characters. I need to remind you that Martha gives this beautiful profession of faith in the Lord Jesus in John chapter 11, where she says, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who was to come to the earth." So the lesson today cannot be, don't be like Martha. So I just need to get that out of the way. Because the reality is that we really need both Martha's and Mary's in our lives and in the world. Bible teacher Beth Moore, she travels a lot, and she once said, if I'm going to stay in someone's home when I travel and speak, I want to stay with a Martha. You could starve to death staying at Mary's place. So, pitting them against each other, Martha versus Mary. Who is better? Who should we be like? That's not helpful. Because both of them and their love for Jesus serve as a model for us. But yes, there is also in the story, and we'll get to that, there is a warning against our desire to be in control. But I want to make sure that we hear that both of these remarkable women have something to show us about a relationship with Jesus. So, let's start with Martha. The text says Martha opened her home to Jesus. In these few words, Martha is described as the head of the household. And now for a Jewish woman in the first century, this is a sign of great tragedy. It either means that she is a widow or she has never been married. Because otherwise she would be connected to some male in that culture. Father, husband, maybe a brother. For her to be the head of the house means there's some terrible tragedy happened, and she is all that is left. It means that she has virtually no position in her society, legally, politically. She's cut off in a lot of ways. Her situation actually is generally seen as a sign of God's displeasure. Man, that's an awful situation you're in. What did you do? Would be maybe not what people would say directly to her, but would be kind of the innuendo. And so such women, women who found themselves in the margins like that, who were not part of a larger home, women in those circumstances were expected to be as invisible as possible, to cling quietly to what little life their culture afforded them. There really wasn't a whole lot of places in that society for single women like Martha. So just stay in the corner, stay out of the way, keep quiet while the rest of us who do have a place go about doing our thing. But here's Martha. Here's Martha opening the door to Jesus and his disciples. Her posture is inviting, it's hospitable, it's generous. All qualities of a good disciple of Jesus, whether in the first century or us here today in the 21st century. She is behaving as any disciple would, welcoming Jesus' presence. Maybe it doesn't strike us so much, but in her time, though, what she is doing is unthinkable. A woman in that position where it seems like God's expressed some displeasure towards her, a woman in that position welcoming a group of men into her home, well, that is certainly not being as invisible as possible. I will tell you that Martha's hospitality, Martha welcoming all those strange men into her house, well, the neighbors will gawk and they will talk. And so I would like to tell you today that Martha is bold, reckless even. She strikes at convention, she ignores impropriety, she acts scandalously against the expectations of women for her day. Martha is willing to put that aside and love Jesus and his friends through her hospitality. And so Jesus enters the house and he begins to teach. It's not just chit-chat. Maybe the text isn't entirely clear, but the original Greek says that Jesus wasn't just speaking, he was speaking the word to them. Jesus was teaching, Jesus was ministering. Not just chit-chat, but serious ministry happening here. And Mary, we read, Mary sits at the Lord's feet listening. Like the rest of the disciples, Mary is taking in every word. Her posture is humble, reverent, teachable. All the qualities of a good disciple in the first century or for us here today in the 21st century. She is behaving like any disciple would, soaking in Jesus' teaching. And again, for us, we might say, okay, that's nice. But in her time and in her culture, once again, this is unthinkable. In Jesus' day, there were only a few things that a woman could do that would be worse than inviting a bunch of strange men into their house. Being taught by a rabbi is one of them. In fact, Jewish leaders in those days, they actually had a saying that went, it is better to burn the Torah, it is better to burn the law than it is to teach it to a woman. Can you believe that? I mean, that's just offensive to us, but that's what they said. It would be better to burn the law than to teach it to a woman. Mary's place is anywhere but at the feet of Jesus. And so Mary, as well as Martha, Mary is bold, reckless even. She strikes at convention, she ignores impropriety, and she acts scandalously against the expectations for women of her day and of her time. Mary loves Jesus through her careful listening. And so you see what's going on here? Both Martha and Mary in this text are doing things contrary to their cultures and their society's expectations. They are being bold and unconventional in their behavior. That's striking, but I think what's also striking is what Jesus does, or how Jesus appears, perhaps is a better way to put it. Jesus appears comfortable with this boldness and this unconventional behavior. Jesus appears comfortable with Mary at his feet, just as he welcomes Martha's hospitality. Even if the neighbors gawk and talk, Jesus is okay with this. We could even go so far to say as Jesus admires them both. So at this part of the story, Jesus doesn't see a problem. Mary listening, Martha serving. The problem is introduced when Martha compares herself to Mary. The problem only enters the text when Martha evaluates Mary against herself. What I'm doing is more important than what you're doing, so get your hiney in the kitchen and give me a hand. I think it's kind of ironic that Martha thinks it's okay to boldly challenge society's expectations for what her role is, but she gets upset when Mary does the same thing, except in her own way, at Jesus' feet. At the end of the text, Jesus says, "Mary has chosen what is better." It's an okay translation, but really the literal Greek is this: Mary has chosen the good part. Now, you could say Mary chose good and Martha chose bad. I go along with the students of Scripture, the students of the original languages, who say, no, Jesus is saying Mary did something good, not as a comparison, as in better, but rather good as in tandem with, similar to Martha. Mary has chosen what is good in that moment, just as Martha has chosen what is good in that moment. Both are beautiful. Both are necessary. I believe that Jesus is refusing to participate in the comparison game. And it just occurs to me how much more contentment there'd be in the world, certainly in my life, if we stopped comparing ourselves to others, and then, because we see others doing things we can't, or affording things we can't, or experiencing things we don't, feeling sorry for ourselves. Imagine what it'd be like if we spent a lot less time doing that. How much more contentment there'd be in the world and in my life if we appreciated and took delight in the gifts and opportunities that God is already giving us, instead of always looking enviously at others. And so comparison, I would say comparison is an issue here. Part of the problem is comparison. The text refers to another problem directly. Martha was distracted by all the preparations. I take this to mean that the problem is not the preparations. The problem is Martha's attitude. Her beautiful hospitality has degenerated into fuss and agitation. And there's a really good reason why we know that the preparations are not the problem. The Greek word behind preparations is diakonia. Diakonia. Anyone, does that word remind you of something that you hear in the church sometimes? Anyone? Deacon. It is often, this word diakonia is often translated as work or service or ministry. And later on in Scripture, it gives us the word that we still have today, deacons. And nowhere in Scripture, anywhere, unless it's here, but I doubt it, nowhere in Scripture is this word ever used negatively. Never. So Martha's preparations, our preparations, our work, that's not the problem in this text or in our lives. Comparison is the problem. Distractions are the problem. Martha's busyness has distracted her. It upsets her. It leads her to making a scene in our text. It's her busyness that's the problem. Again, Beth Moore, she writes, "If Satan can't make us bad, he'll make us busy." And he finds both are effective. Now, you could say that Satan can't make us do anything, but at least with me, he still often gets lots of cooperation. If Satan can't make us bad, well, then he'll make us busy, and he finds both equally effective. Jesus points this out. But I want us to notice how gently he does so. Martha, Martha, he says, using her name twice. It'd be interesting to go through Scripture. And I did, but I put it to a footnote because otherwise this gets too long. But look through Scripture. Who else does Jesus named twice. Martha, Martha. Stanley, Stanley. Mandy, Mandy. Who else in Scripture does Jesus name twice, and what are the contexts there? There's some homework for you to do. I tell you that Martha, Martha, that double name is spoken gently and meant to remind Martha, not to scold her, but to remind her, maybe scold, that's maybe not quite the right, certainly not to judge her, but to remind her of her true identity. Martha, Martha. So Jesus speaks gently to her. Jesus acknowledges Martha's emotions, that she's worried and upset. Jesus recognizes that. He names that. In fact, Martha had said, "Lord, don't you care?" Jesus' answer reveals that he indeed does see Martha, and he does indeed care for Martha, and he has all along. "Yes, Martha," Jesus says, "I care for you, and I affirm you just as I affirm Mary and what she is doing." Jesus approves of the fact that Martha is out in the kitchen making them a meal, just as he approves of the fact that Mary is there sitting and learning from him. Martha has been doing the right thing in her situation, as has Mary, though they were doing different things. And so what we're learning here is that it's not about elevating one above the other. This story is teaching us to discern when to rest and be still, and when it's time to get going and to do the work to which you're called. Now, my timing for either may not be the same as your timing for either, and that's okay. And I say that it's okay, but of course the temptation is that I always know what's best, and that I want to call the shots like Martha. No, it's not time for you to be at the feet of Jesus. It's time for you to be in the kitchen. Get over here and help me. I think I know what's best. I like to call the shots. I'm a lot like Martha, who wants to domineer her sibling. I say that Martha even tries to manipulate Jesus in our story today, to use Jesus as her heavy hammer for hitting Sister Mary over the head. "Tell her to help me," she says, triangulating Jesus in this conflict. Domineering, manipulating, controlling. You know anyone like that? I just have to look in the mirror every morning. And I suspect that all of us can be like that more often than we care to admit. I mean, of course I want Jesus to be in control of my life, except when I don't. Right? Someone pointed out to me this past week something that pastor and author Timothy Keller wrote. He wrote that the most pervasive idols to which 21st century North Americans, so the most pervasive idols to which you and I will succumb, are those promising us power, approval, comfort, and you got it, control. A lot of our other idols, maybe even all of the other things that we will put in place of God, somehow fit under those four, including control. That idol of control. Like Martha, I want to be in charge. Like Martha, I want to be in charge. You know that desire too? I kind of suspect you do. What we, like Martha, have to learn is that when we are sharing our life with the Lord Jesus Christ, we are not in charge. He's in charge. And when Jesus is in charge, he changes things. Out with worldly, selfish, hurtful, power-hungry tendencies. In with kingdom, selfless, healing, sacrificial tendencies. Out with sin and death, in with forgiveness and life. Maybe Martha's used to being the big bossy sister, domineering, manipulating, controlling her younger sister, Mary. I mean, she'd never put it that way, of course. No. And besides, it's all been for Mary's well-being, for her own good, for her to get her head out of the clouds, for crying out loud. Maybe Martha invites Jesus into her home and assumes that Jesus will say, "Yep, just the way things are perfect. Nothing for me to do here." Maybe she assumes that she can go back to business as usual if nothing being changed after Jesus has been in her home. Or at least, if Jesus is going to change some things, at least let Martha be the one who chooses what changes in her home and her relationships and what didn't. Thank you very much. But Jesus tells Martha and us that it doesn't work that way. Once Jesus is invited in, once he begins to become a part of our lives, all of life will be different. All of life will be changed and will continue to change as we grow as disciples of Jesus. Everything will be changed, including, maybe even especially, our relationships with one another. You see, Jesus does not fit neatly into a world and a life that is already pretty well constructed. Everything neat and tidy just the way it is. Nope, I'm afraid that Jesus comes and he messes things up. He messes things up and forces everything to be reconsidered and reevaluated. I think I have everything neat and tidy. Jesus comes in and says, "I'm going to change some things. I'm going to make things look more like the kingdom. I'm going to make things more reveal the love to which we just confessed and described in our readings and sang earlier." Jesus is going to change things when he comes in, and change makes a mess, at least from my perspective. Life changes when Jesus is invited in. In fact, I would be as so bold as to say that if we want things to remain exactly the way they are, we are essentially telling God to be quiet. I would go be as bold as to say that. If we want things to stay exactly the way they are right now, don't change anything, we're telling God, be quiet. And I tell you, that is hard for someone like me who wants to be and wants to hang on to control. Although I do think, maybe you disagree with me, but I'd like to think that increasingly, as I'm getting a little bit older, I think I'm realizing a bit more, and I realize I got more to learn, but I think I'm realizing that grabbing, holding on to control is often like going after a mirage on the horizon. Jesus gently, and sometimes not so gently, invites me to unclench my fingers around that illusion of control and to surrender to his control and to bow down in worship to him. Because whether I acknowledge it or not, but things always go better when I do, whether I acknowledge it or not, Jesus is in charge. Jesus is in control. Even when he appeared not to be in control, hanging on the cross, even when it looked like he was no longer in charge, he still was in control, taking our sins in himself and then bursting out of the grave, Lord of all. I realize that a lot of times it is hard to do, but things are always better when we submit to Jesus' control. Letting go of control helps us welcome the changes that Jesus wants to make in our lives. Letting go of control puts us in a better position to trust and obey him and allow him to be the Lord and us to be the disciple instead of the other way around. And as his Spirit works in us, he'll meet us with Mary as we follow his feet in contemplation, prayer, and worship. And he'll direct us in our work and relationships, like Martha, in the kitchen, in the shop, in the classroom, at the hotel, in the office, in the barn, in the truck. As we give up control, he'll help us to discern what he desires us to do. And then he'll equip us to do it. And we'll discover that that's a way better path than the one we were on when we insisted that we were in control ourselves. Will you pray with me? Lord Jesus, we confess that we like to be, that we're addicted to thinking that we're in control. Often we limit you, trying to keep you in a neat little box when you know that's better for you to mess some things up in our lives so that they better align with your character and your will. Help us let go of demanding what should stay the same and what should change. We make the serenity prayer our own. Grant us the serenity to accept the things we cannot change, the courage to change the things we can, and the wisdom to know the difference. Lead us in delighting in you, whether it's in quiet contemplation with Mary or in active service with Martha, each in their good time. And change us with your Holy Spirit as you will in the process. Amen. As we go from this place with the Holy Spirit prompting and equipping us to trust and obey, we go knowing that our God goes with us. And remind us that the kindergartners through second graders and the children's worship kids, they will be coming up front here to sing after the service. The remaining Sunday school kids, you are welcome to your classes out the back. Sixth to seventh grade boys' Sunday school class, you will not meet today. So if you're a sixth or seventh grade boy in Pastor Henry's class, you will not be meeting today. Instead, what you are going to do is you are going to hang out in the back and you are going to talk with someone who is at least two times older than you are, and you are going to ask them, why is being part of a church so important? And then what you're going to do is you're going to write down on a piece of paper your name, the name of the person you talked to, what they answered, and you're going to put it in my mail slot, and you'll get a prize. Any questions, 7th and 8th graders? There you go. Enjoy your conversations afterwards, and us who are a little older, welcome and unfold some 7th and 8th grade boys who are running around looking for something to do, okay? And I remind you that the Art of Parenting class continues in the praise room. As we go from this place, may Christ be with you, beneath you and behind you. May Christ be in you, before you and above you. May Christ be on your right and on your left. May Christ be where you lie and where you sit and where you rise. May Christ be in the heart of everyone who thinks of you, in every eye that sees you, and in every ear that hears you. Salvation is of the Lord. Salvation is of the Christ. May the salvation of our Lord be ever with you. And together the people of God say, Amen.